Good evening, and thank you so much for joining us tonight on Facebook, YouTube, and Twitch to participate in this live event with Dinesh D’Souza. Tonight, Dinesh will discuss the future of the American dream after 2020 and take questions from you, our viewers. Stick around, and in just a minute, I'll tell you how you can ask Dinesh your questions and hear the answers right here. But first, my name is Madison Habersetzer, and I serve as a program officer with Young America's Foundation at the Reagan Ranch. Young America's Foundation is committed to ensuring that increasing numbers of young people hear and are inspired by the ideas of individual freedom, a strong national defense, free enterprise, and traditional American values. We accomplished this mission by providing essential seminars, conferences, educational materials, internships, campus lectures, and virtual programs such as tonight's. Before we begin, I would like to give a very special thank you to Keith Work, who has generously sponsored many campus lectures, including tonight's event featuring the one and only Dinesh D’Souza. Born in Mumbai, India, Dinesh has truly lived the American dream. He moved to the United States to attend school at Dartmouth College, and after graduation, he went on to work in the Reagan White House as a policy analyst. Additionally, Dinesh served as a fellow at the American Enterprise Institute and at Stanford University, and served as president of the King's College in New York City from 2010 to 2012. Dinesh is also, and perhaps most famously, a best-selling author and renowned filmmaker. His first two films, 2016 Obama's America and America, Imagine a World Without Her, are respectively the second and sixth highest grossing political documentaries of all time. Since those movies, Dinesh has released Hillary's America and Death of a Nation, both of which smashed other records in their own right. His latest film, Trump Card, builds on this success and is an expose of the socialism, corruption, and gangsterization that now define the Democratic Party. Trump Card is streaming now on all video on-demand platforms across the web. As the author of numerous nationally renowned books, too many of them, number one New York Times bestsellers to list here, Dinesh has been invited to speak to groups all over the country on politics, philosophy, and Christianity. His razor-sharp wit and entertaining style have allowed him to participate in highly publicized debates about politics and Christianity with some of the most famous atheists and leftists of our time, including Christopher Hitchens, Bill Ayers, and others. One of Dinesh's favorite venues for debates and speeches has always been college campuses. As a longtime partner to Young America's Foundation, he has spent nearly 30 years appearing at hundreds of colleges and universities and speaking with hundreds of thousands of students in live lecture and debate settings. In about 20 minutes, I'm going to start asking Dinesh your questions from the chat boxes live right here. I'll explain more about how we will select those questions after we bring Dinesh up. But for now, just start dropping your questions in the chat on Facebook, YouTube, or Twitch. Before you send your question, make sure to follow or subscribe. We'll only be taking questions tonight from followers on Facebook and Twitch and subscribers on YouTube. So hit that like, follow, or subscribe button and start dropping us your questions. We only have a limited amount of Dinesh's time, so make sure they're good. And with that, I'm so excited to introduce Dinesh D’Souza.
Thank you very much. I'm delighted to be here. I've had a long-standing relationship with Young America's Foundation, and I'm always thrilled to be presenting on their behalf. I'm particularly grateful to Keith Work for his sponsorship of this series, and boy, this could not come at a more critical time. Our nation is in a certain kind of deep crisis, and it's not just a crisis of who won the election, because it is not just this election, but every election that hangs in the balance, the integrity of the election process itself. But this is not even just about elections, because it's also about all the other surrounding institutions that have defined American politics, and their legitimacy is at stake. The pollsters, who tried to create a kind of weird sense of inevitability around this stumbling, bumbling candidate, trying to give us the idea that the emperor really did have some clothes on, and not only that, he was marching to his coronation inexorably with no one really standing in the way. Wrong. And then the media, This is the media that has abandoned all pretense of objectivity, a media that you can't even call to a higher standard because it has no higher standard if it has standards at all, a media that does not hesitate to suppress the biggest story of the election, which was the habitual career-long corruption of one of the two leading candidates, a man who literally took his family members on foreign trips as bag men to collect money from him. And then when he obtusely said, I never took any money from a foreign country, meaning, of course, he took it from the family members, there was literally no one in the country to ask him about it. So the media is now in question. And what this shows, I think, ultimately, is that a great deal is at stake here. I was on the Bill O'Reilly show today, and Bill was arguing really that Trump has one and only one path to victory, and that is ultimately to win Arizona and then to have the added ballots in the sort of three additional days in Pennsylvania tossed out. State law requires that the ballots be in by 8 p.m. on election day. A judge decided, let's give it a grace period. This flatly violates Pennsylvania law. And O'Reilly was suggesting that that's the only way. But I think that there's a wider issue here, and that is the notion of systematic, built-in corruption. And the way to look at that is to essentially reason from, I would call it, statistical impossibilities. What is the chance that there could be 138,000 consecutive votes for Biden? That chance, statistically, is essentially zero. What is the chance that if you see a pattern of Trump votes all the way through Election Day running alongside, in fact, better than the other Republican candidates, and then mysteriously after the election, after Election Day, the other Republican candidates' votes hold according to pattern, but Trump's votes and Trump's votes alone take a nosedive? The statistical probability of that is also essentially zero. So I wish, I hope, I pray that the Supreme Court here does not look at this in a narrow way. Let's just give Pennsylvania to Trump. But in its broadest implications, because I think we're dealing here with the integrity of basic institutions. In thinking about America's crisis now, my mind flashes back to when I first set foot in America, young, fresh-eyed, 17 years old, with $500 in my pocket, looking at a country that offered me not only ladders of opportunity, not only the chance to make my life better, to materially improve my condition, but also a country that would allow me to be in the driver's seat of my own life, a country that would allow me to be the architect of my own destiny. And I've lived out this American dream. Let's remember, no other country really has this kind of a dream. There's clearly no Indian dream. The Chinese don't have a dream. Well, the French might have a dream, but I don't think we want to know what it is. So this American dream is unique. And now it stands in America as the only blockade against a different kind of ideology, the socialist ideology. Now, I grew up under socialism. India was a socialist country in the 1960s and 70s. And for me, socialism is defined by scarcity. Our family had a ration card telling my mom that she could buy only so much rice and sugar and cooking oil. We were on a 7-year waiting list to get a phone. India at that time was the begging bowl of the world, and socialism was a big part of the reason for that. So here is socialism, a discredited ideology, in fact, the most discredited idea since slavery. And it was discredited largely because, you can see this in all the great thinkers, from Hayek to Solzhenitsyn to George Orwell, they understood that socialism was a form of slavery. Now imagine if someone were to say today, you know, slavery was an excellent idea, but the implementation was always poor. We would consider such a person to be a raving lunatic. But this is exactly what people say about socialism. This time we're going to get it right. This time we're going to make it work. Here is an ideology that was tried in 25 countries in the last century, collapsed in every one of them. The big countries, Russia, China, India, all jettisoned socialism. So how is it possible that this crazy, whacked out scheme could not only make its way into the mainstream of American politics, worm its way ultimately to the Democratic Party, and come really into the American bloodstream for the first time in our country's history? Now, the socialists will say, we are developing here in America a new type of socialism. First of all, it's not authoritarian socialism, it's democratic socialism. Now, first of all, this idea that democratic socialism is somehow novel is complete nonsense. I grew up under democratic socialism. India has been a democratic country since 1947 when it became independent from the British. But the deeper point is that democratic socialism, the idea that socialism can somehow be vindicated by popular consent, and that the transactions of socialism acquire some sort of moral authority because people voted for them, I want to sort of illustrate why that is inherently suspect and indeed false. When I was a kid in high school going to school, at recess we would play marbles, and I'd take marbles in my pocket and go to school. Now imagine if on the way I was confronted by one guy, let's call him the authoritarian socialist, and he jumps me, beats me up, takes my marbles. That's authoritarian socialism. But now here's the second case. I'm off to school with my marbles, and I'm confronted now by 10 guys who proceed to take a vote, and 7-3, by a majority vote, they agree, let's jump Dinesh, beat him up, and take his marbles. So in both cases, the outcome is the same. In both cases, I've been robbed. Who cares that they took a vote and decided by majority decision to do this? Ultimately, the moral content of the transaction remains the same. The second theme of modern American socialism is we want to be modeled on Scandinavia. You keep hearing this from AOC, from Bernie Sanders, from Elizabeth Warren, from others. The idea that, you know, there's one place, Scandinavia, where socialism really does work. But the simple fact is that there is no one on the left who really wants to do what the Scandinavians do. Scandinavia has a very peculiar type of socialism. In fact, they're not socialist in wealth creation. They're capitalist in wealth creation, even if socialist in wealth distribution. So what does that mean? Well, the Scandinavian countries have corporate tax rates around 20%, pretty much the same as here. They have, for the most part, no minimum wage. You can hire and fire people for any reason. There's less regulation than in the United States. With the exception of one Scandinavian country, Norway, there is no wealth tax. None of the Scandinavian countries have an inheritance tax. Finland tried universal basic income. They found it didn't work. They chucked it out. So the Scandinavians do not kill the goose that lays the golden eggs. When it comes to the welfare state, they've got a big welfare state. But here's the key point. They distribute the burden of that welfare state across the whole society. And what that means is that they don't demonize the rich. They don't try to rob Peter to pay Paul in the hope of getting Paul's vote. The Scandinavians have high taxes on the rich, but they have equally high taxes on the middle class, and they have equally high taxes on the poor. In fact, the Scandinavians have the so-called VAT tax, the value-added tax, which is a consumption tax, 25%. And any economist will tell you that a consumption tax, the VAT tax, falls heavier proportionately on the poor and on the middle class than it does on the rich. The bottom line, the Scandinavian model is not a model that anyone on the left is really pursuing. Now, socialism in America is, well, I call it identity socialism. Why? Because it's a weird marriage, a weird hybrid of classic socialism and identity politics. That is one thing that does make it new. If you read Marx, the sort of apostle of socialism, Marx really talks about society as divided between the rich and the poor. It's a class divide. On the one side, you have the greedy capitalists, the bad guys, the exploiters. On the other side, you have the workers. They're supposed to be the exploited. And that's Marx's fundamental division. It's an economic division. But interestingly, in America, the left divides society many different ways. There's a class divide, yes, they want to set rich against poor, but they also have a race divide, black against white, and a gender divide, male against female, and a sort of sexual orientation divide, if you will, straight against gay, even a divide between legal and illegals. So the left is trying to carve American society, to put a wedge here and there and everywhere. Why? Because their goal ultimately is to try to create a sort of majority coalition of oppressed victims. This is really not about economic confiscation by itself. In fact, the typical leftist today cares more about abortion than they do the minimum wage. They care more about the transgender bathroom than they do about universal basic income. There's a sort of a cultural Marxism that runs alongside economic confiscation. And the long-term goal of the left, I mean, one that they're pursuing even now and pretty aggressively, is the idea of creating a conformity across the whole society. They want to achieve this how? In part, by creating an atmosphere of ostracism, of censorship. If you go against them, you get fired from your job, you get thrown off a digital platform. They want ultimately everyone to pay obeisance to their ideology. And they're not content with dominating academia and the media. They're not content with having the whole entertainment industry, not just Hollywood, but also Broadway and the music industry, pretty much all the comedians. They want the NFL. They want the Boy Scouts. They want to beat every institution into submission. They want the Colorado Christian baker. They want to force people to say what they don't want to say. You better bake a cake, even if it violates your conscience, and put this message on it, even if you don't agree with it. And if you won't do it, we'll sue you. And if you go to the Supreme Court and win, we'll sue you again. Why? The idea is not just to terrorize this poor man into submission, but to terrorize everyone around him, all of us, into believing that if we follow that example, this is the fate that awaits us. I was really struck by recently AOC talking about creating a kind of enemies list of people who are sort of associated with Trump. Try to prevent those people from getting jobs, working even in the private sector. The idea here is the Trump Accountability Project. We have a list. I mean, not since McCarthyism have we seen this kind of effort to treat political opponents not just as people that they disagree with, but that people that they want to destroy. I saw this a little bit myself with my own case with the Obama Justice Department. It was very clear to me that if they could have locked me up for 10 years, for 20 years, over a trivial offense, an offense for which no other American has even been prosecuted, let alone locked up, they would have done it. Why? Because from the point of view of these people, I wasn't a critic, I wasn't a dissident, I wasn't somebody who embarrassed Obama with my movie. Rather, I was an enemy, and they wanted to take me out. In the movie Trump Card, we have a chilling scene which is based on Orwell's 1984, in which the main character, Winston, is being interrogated by the socialist regime, by the deep state, what Orwell calls Big Brother. And Big Brother's trying to force Winston to admit that 2 + 2 = 5. And Winston goes, I will not do it. You have taken everything from me. You've deprived me of all my freedom. You've cut me off from my family. You've locked me up. But no, for me, the only freedom I have left is the freedom to insist that 2 + 2 = 4. And so what do? They lock him up, sensory deprivation, no food. He's scared of rats, so they put rats on him. And finally, the poor man breaks down And he concedes. He admits it. 2 + 2, he says, is 5. And can I go now? And Big Brother, in effect, replies, no, Winston, you can't go. Because in your mind, you still think it's 4. You're only saying 5 because you want the pain to stop. You're only saying 5 because you know that's what we want to hear. We insist not merely on outward conformity, but on inner submission. So this is really, I think, in the end, Orwell was a man of the left, but he understood that all forms of socialism in the end push in the direction of tyranny. And ultimately what the left wants is they want to turn us, I believe, into worms. They want to make us into second-class citizens. They want to make us ultimately salute and give, if you will, the Heil Hitler to their ideology. And if not, they are promising to crush us. Now, what gives the left this extreme chutzpah? What has allowed this gangsterization of the other side, there's no more polite word for it, to have gathered so much momentum? Why do they feel that they can get away with it? Who would dream of trying to rig a whole election and feel a sense of immunity about it? Well, basically, I believe the reason that the left does this is that they are convinced that we, the conservatives, the Christians, we are the party of the nice guys, which is to say, from their point of view, we are the party of the wimps. And what they think is that they can do stuff to us that we will never do to them. And this gives them their sense of entitlement, their sense of immunity. So their philosophy is we can knock down your statues. Why? Because we know that you wouldn't dream of knocking down ours. And we can use the deep state, the police agencies of government, the FBI, the CIA, the DOJ, the IRS. We can sic them on you. We can go after you. Why? Because we know that even if you control the apparatus of the state, you wouldn't dream of using the deep state against us. So there is a sense, we'll pack the court. Why? Because they're confident that even if the conservatives controlled all the branches of government, conservatives wouldn't dream of packing the court. And finally, we on the left can rig an election. Why? Because we know that you're the straight-laced people. Even if you could, you wouldn't dream of doing it. In fact, look at all these election irregularities. Look at all this ballot fixing, dead people voting. You notice something? None of the irregularities are on the Trump side. Even the media is now saying, well, of course there could be some irregularity. Well, of course there's going to be some fraud. They know that the fraud is always on their side. And isn't it telling that all of this, even the digital censorship, it's not just a matter of a bunch of goons, a bunch of morons who decide, oh, I'm going to kick this guy off Facebook. I'm going to kick this guy off Twitter. I mean, that would be Kafkaesque enough, eerie enough. But the censorship only cuts in one direction. The good news is that we are waking up to this. We are waking up to the fraudulence of the media. And I don't just mean we're aware that they're biased. The bottom line of it is we realize we don't even have a real media. When the founders thought about a media, when you think about a media in the classic sense, you think about a group of people who are independent of government, removed from government, captive to neither side, applying a kind of critical lens on government, of ferreting out valuable information and sharing it with the American people so the American people can adjudicate what's true, what's false, what's important, what's not, what's good, what's evil. And you only have to spell things out like this to realize that we don't even have a media in this sense. Our media, yeah, they have press badges and they've got all these credentials, but they're frauds. Ultimately, they're like political operatives for one side. And we have to figure out to reduce the power of the media in our minds. That is the ultimate challenge. Longer term, even beyond Trump, even beyond the election, the deep question I believe that conservatives have to ask is this one. What are we going to do about a left that wants to force us to live in their world? Now, what I mean by that is that they want us to go to their schools where they can indoctrinate our children and turn our children against the values and will of their parents. They want parents to subsidize their children's education in college. And yet they want the professors, again, to be able to drum into these young people, again, a set of values and also a set of facts, which are not facts, which ultimately are nothing more than the progressive narrative in its full spin mode. The untruths I've discovered that I unleash in my movies, basically academia is just as dishonest as the media. In academia, they don't cover up the Biden financial scandal, but what they cover up are the crimes of the Democratic Party, the crimes of the left. What they cover up is a whole history of leftist complicity and Democratic complicity in slavery, in segregation, in Jim Crow, in the Ku Klux Klan, in racial terrorism, in so-called Negro barbecues in which black men were dangling from trees organized by local chapters of the Democratic Party. You won't find this in the history books. You won't find it on Wikipedia. You won't find it in the History Channel. So a kind of deep deception has now become the order of the day, in which the lies of academia are refracted into the lies of the media. Those are then picked up in Hollywood. And so we're living at a time where we have to adjudicate, look through the fog, look through the mirage, and try to figure out what's true. Long term, I believe, we have to literally detach ourselves from these institutions. In their current form, they are irredeemable. And I think what that means is that we have to create our own educational structures, both at the elementary and secondary school and at the college level. Maybe this can be done online by creating high quality online education that can be delivered at a much lower cost. And this would destroy the existing model of higher education. We have to create our own entertainment, our own movies. Not just documentary films, but also feature films. The big guy in Hollywood is not Michael Moore. Well, I mean, the big guy in Hollywood is Michael Moore. But what I mean is that the gold standard of Hollywood is the feature film. We have to have our own stand-up comedians. Ultimately, what I'm suggesting is that we've got to create an alternative culture, conservative, Christian, hospitable to decent values. Otherwise, we're submitting to the rank perversion, indoctrination, censorship, intimidation, and really domestic terrorism off the other side. It's a real pity that America has come to this critical pass. I'm a creature of the Reagan era, and that was, in fact, a kinder, gentler America. But we don't live in that America. Let's remember that in the Reagan era, the battle was a Cold War against a foreign adversary. We're now living, and I say this in both my book, United States of Socialism, also in the movie Trump Card, we're now living in a cold civil war in which we're dealing with a domestic opponent and an opponent that refuses to see us as fellow citizens. This is the true meaning of their bogus call to unity. Would they be calling for unity if we won the election? Certainly not. Their idea of unity is for us ultimately to submit to them. A two-tier society. My wife is from Venezuela. That's the model they have in mind. The Venezuelans are starving, but the Chavistas live high on the hog. Ultimately, you have a socialist elite class that runs things, and everybody else is reduced to poverty and misery and begging. Are we going to lose this battle? In my opinion, no. Why? Because I think that the patriots and the conservatives and the Christians are waking up. They're waking up in the same way that the Republican Party woke up in the 1850s and 1860s. Abraham Lincoln was a very moderate man. But he realized he was in an immoderate situation. He realized that the other side, the Democratic Party, had become gangsterized. And he realized most of all that they needed to be taught a lesson. He also realized that he was going to do to them what they did to him. When the Union Army first deployed black soldiers, the Confederacy issued an order that any black soldier captured by the Confederacy would be immediately executed. This verdict would not apply to white soldiers who were normal prisoners of war. When this came to the attention of Lincoln, Lincoln issued what has now come to be known by historians as the Order of Retaliation. For any black Union soldier captured and executed by the Confederacy, one Confederate captive will be shot. Now, by the standards of today, by the standards of the Geneva Convention, this is an order of extreme barbarity. Why would a moderate man, Lincoln, issue such an immoderate order? The answer is simple. He realized he had to do to them what they were doing to him, or they would never stop. And in fact, the Confederates did stop, and Lincoln withdrew the executive order. This is a moment of crisis, but by crisis, I mean opportunity, I mean choice, and I want to close with the great words of Lincoln himself. He said, "The fiery trial through which we pass will light us in honor or in dishonor down to the latest generation." I believe that with courage and wisdom, we can win this fight. We can ultimately overcome, not overcome the Democrats, but overcome the gangsterism of the other side. Return to civility, return to normalcy, return to that America that Reagan himself so beautifully invoked in 1984 when he spoke about his dream of mourning in America. Thank you very much.
Thanks again for taking the time to be with us tonight, Dinesh. I want to just pause for a minute and say a special thank you to everyone watching online. We're so excited that you're all here with us tonight. As I promised, Dinesh has some time now to take your questions. We're going to take questions from all sides tonight, so no holds barred. And I have the first question queued up and ready to go. Before we get started, I wanted to remind you that you can drop your questions right now in real time into the chat box on whatever platform you're using. So if you're on Facebook, use that comment section right below this video. If you're on YouTube or Twitch on the desktop app, just drop them into the chat box to the right of this stream. In the YouTube and Twitch apps on your phone, it's under the video. Remember, you have to be a follower or subscriber to ask a question. So if you're on Facebook, hit that thumbs up to like the YAF page. If you're on YouTube, ring that bell and subscribe to YAF TV. If you're on Twitch, click that little heart button below this video to follow YAF Gaming. I only have the first question picked out so far, so there's still plenty of time to get yours in. Dinesh is a busy man, and we can't keep him forever, so we'll be selecting the best and most interesting questions from all three platforms. Take a minute now and drop your best questions in the chat. And remember, follow or subscribe if you want a chance to have your question featured tonight. Okay, Dinesh, here's what we have to start. A viewer from Twitch asks, do you believe that the left will be less violent if Biden takes up residence in the White House?
Weirdly, I think the answer is yes. And the reason is a little paradoxical. It's not just that the left will believe, hey, our guy won, so we don't have to go set fire to things and beat people up and drag people out of cars and threaten people in restaurants. But it's more that the thugs on the street will find their way into the government. So it's actually not good news. It's scary news. In fact, this is exactly what happened with fascist movements in Italy and in Germany. In Italy, for example, Mussolini's black shirts joined the government. Hitler, when he came to power, and I'm not talking about the Hitler of the Holocaust, but early Hitler, he disbanded the brown shirts. Those were street thugs who were on his side, but he goes, I don't need the street thugs. Why? I've got the German police. I've got the German army. So the idea here is to move from the random episodic violence of the street to now the violence from the state itself. So this would be my greater fear, that we'd be moving from the episodic excesses of Antifa, Black Lives Matter, to now a state that has in its whole terrifying power that it can unleash on citizens.
Our next question comes from a viewer on Facebook who asks, why are so many conservative women and people of color being elected to Congress? Doesn't that fly in the face of the left's narrative?
It totally destroys the narrative, because the narrative is that it was captured really by Biden's, you know, you have to vote for me or you ain't black, But it was the idea that blacks are not individuals. They don't have independent thoughts. They are part of a sort of a racial group. This is identity politics, that what's most important about them is their blackness. And the Democratic Party is sort of like, have we got a deal for you? And the deal is that we supply you with a meager livelihood, and we've been doing it since the 60s, and you in exchange have to vote for us. So this is the sort of plantation bargain, the new plantation that LBJ set up. And any black who votes Republican is seen as somebody who's sort of escaping the plantation. He's a runaway. And so all these merciless accusations descend upon him. Well, I think Trump has ultimately broken this kind of grip that the left has on blacks. Now, they were trying to establish it on Latinos as well. It's a tougher task, but they were making headway. And the fact that Trump has increased his Latino vote. So there are opportunities, I believe, for conservatives to now make the kind of inroads among blacks and Latinos and Asian Americans, by the way. I've puzzled for a long time why Asian Americans aren't voting conservative, for the simple reason that their lifestyle is to the right of Pat Robertson. It makes every sense. There are people who believe in merit and entrepreneurship and hard work. And yet, I think what happens is that the Asian American kids, they go into the universities, they go into these elite campuses, and they're eager to assimilate. And what do? They end up assimilating to the progressive culture that is entrenched in those universities. And so against their own values, against even their own interests, they end up in a camp where to be cool, to be accepted, and in their view, to be American, they have to spout the inanities of the left.
Our next question comes from Luke on Twitch. He asks, you mentioned the ways Obama weaponized the DOJ and IRS. What can we expect if Biden takes office? What do we do to protect ourselves from the left weaponizing the government?
We'll be a little bit vulnerable to that, again, as we were under Obama. And we now know that these guys are capable of extreme ruthlessness. And this is something, by the way, that doesn't define the history of the Democratic Party. It has been episodically true in the past, but Jimmy Carter wasn't like that. JFK wasn't like that. Truman wasn't like that. And I don't believe that that even Dukakis was like that. But Obama and Hillary, it started under Clinton. It became worse under Obama. I mean, I don't for a minute believe that Strzok and Page and Comey and Clapper and Brennan all went on independent expeditions. Oh, let's do surveillance. Let's try to get Flynn. Let's try to get Trump. No, the order came from Obama. And that means that the president of the United States was weaponized using the power at his disposal, including the secret agencies of government. By the way, recruiting foreign intelligence agencies into this. To do what? Subvert the presidency of his legitimately elected successor. This is one of the most chilling things one could say about American democracy. The subverter in chief was sitting in the Oval Office himself. But it's almost as if the left dares us. You know, we dare you to show up at his house. We dare you to produce an indictment. We dare you to bring out the handcuffs. And conservatives always want to be very cautious, to cross every T, dot every I. I don't know what happened with Jeff Sessions. He became Rip Van Winkle and went to sleep for 3 years. But Trump didn't control his Justice Department for most of his term. This is why I think it's so important that this would be a crucial part of the unfinished agenda of the Trump second term. But of course, if Biden comes in, and this is why the deep state is so much behind him, they would be back in business.
Our next question comes from a viewer on YouTube. He asks, what should we take away from the media's coverage over the last 2 weeks? Is it time now to reevaluate how we get our news?
It seems to me of critical importance that we start tomorrow, yesterday, in building massive new channels. Now, I'm already doing this on digital media. And I'm growing exponentially on those platforms, platforms like Parler, an alternative to Twitter, Rumble, which is a sort of alternative to YouTube. So I think it's essential that we don't quit Twitter, but also set up at Parler. Don't quit YouTube, but also set up at Rumble. That way you don't have this sword of Damocles hanging over your head. In case the morons ban you, boom, you've got somewhere else to go. And my Parler following, which was essentially negligible a few months ago, is now like 1.7 million. I'll probably overtake my Twitter following tomorrow. So it's amazing how these plot. But now, I think on the media front, we need a massive channel. And when my family met with Trump last November, he weirdly asked me, he goes, what do you think I should do sort of post-presidency? And I said, well, Mr. President, you should start a network. I said, not a cable network, not talk radio on TV, but a network that reaches 70, 80, 90 million Americans. And I go, listen, not only do you have the name, the brand, the money, the influence, but most importantly, you already have the audience. If you take your social media and you add it up, it's well over 100 million people. So let the other networks all compete for one half of the country, and you take the other half. So I see this as an incredible business opportunity. And so my advice to the Trumps, get out of real estate, start a network.
Our next question comes from a viewer on YouTube. He asks, isn't capitalism exploitative? Wouldn't socialism be a more moral model?
Well, socialism is essentially a form of stealing. And here's what I mean by that. If somebody were to tell you, go over to your neighbor's house and open their refrigerator and eat their food and look around the wall, if you see some paintings, just take them, look around their house, you see nice stuff, bring it over to your house. What would you say? Well, you'd say, I'm not gonna do that, I'm not a thief. And if you did it, you'd feel ashamed of yourself because your conscience would revolt. But now along comes the socialist who says to you, hey, listen, you know that stuff in your neighbor's house? It actually belongs to you. Now, true, you don't think so, and that guy never came over and took it. But what if his great-great-great-great-great-grandfather stole it from your great-great-great-great-grandfather? So in other words, he's in possession of stolen goods that have been passed down from generation to generation. And the good news, according to the socialist, is look, you don't have to do anything. We, the state, will go and grab it from him. We'll forcibly extract it from him. We'll keep some of it for ourselves, and we'll give the rest of it to you. So you see what's going on here? In the name of social justice, and that's the camouflage, what the socialist is doing is turning an honest man, or an honest woman in your case, into a thief. They're making you feel good about this burglary or larceny operation with the state as the sort of mechanism for carrying it out. There's nothing honest about this scheme whatsoever. It's ultimately a scheme for taking what doesn't belong to you, a violation of one of the fundamental commandments.
A viewer from Twitch asks, based on your lecture tonight, it makes sense that you want to see conservatives use some of the tactics of the left to win, much like you say Lincoln did. My question is, where is the line? How do we know the point we can approach but not cross?
Well, I think that the line is something that there is a line. I mean, let's put it this way. We aren't actually going to go knock down their monuments. I'm not recommending that we do. But I do think this, that if an Antifa guy breaks a window, the solution to that is not a strongly worded op-ed in National Review Online calling for civility. That's not going to do it. In fact, if that guy breaks a window and nothing happens to him, he'll break every window in the neighborhood. He measures that as success. If the left can show up and get a conservative speaker banned from a campus, that to them is a victory. So the point I'm trying to make is that you've got to grab that guy and hold him accountable. If someone is pulling down a Columbus statue, and the cops grab him and he's looking at 5 years in prison, the message goes out to his friends, let's not try to knock down federal statues because we might not be showing up to mom's basement tonight. So that's what I'm getting at. We need to toughen up as a team and recognize that you have to impose appropriate, severe penalties on these guys. Same with the deep state. You have to bust up the deep state. These guys have got to realize they can't get away with this. If they do get away with this, it's open season on Americans.
A viewer from Twitch asks, hasn't Trump stoked the flames of identity politics over the last 4 years? Can we begin to undo that damage now?
This to me is pure gobbledygook because Trump far from stoking the flames of identity politics, never appeals to people solely on the basis of skin color. His argument to blacks, and his argument is, when he says, what do you have to lose, what he's trying to say is, let's try the American formula instead of the identity politics formula. Don't think of yourself as black. Think of yourself as a patriot. Don't think about you as a member of the black working class. You're a member of the working class. So with Trump, there is an effort, I think, the two things you can say about Trump is, whatever you think about his personality or shooting from the hip or the fact that he's a mud wrestler, the bottom line of it is he's an entrepreneur and a capitalist. That's undeniable. And he's a patriot. That's undeniable. I think the reason that there are so many new faces in the Republican Party, I just mean not just the bow-tied Latino or African-American that was a familiar sight at a Republican event, but I mean blacks from the inner city. The reason is they resonate with Trump. He talks to them like normal human beings. He speaks a colloquial kind of everyday language, and they recognize the guy doesn't have a racist bone in his body.
Jason from Facebook asks, what accomplishments of Trump will be the first on the left's chopping block if we lose the White House? Which accomplishments could last?
I think that even if Trump were to be a one-term president, I don't think he will be, but if he were, he will have transformed American politics in dramatic ways. Just look, for example, at the way he's transformed the Republican Party. First of all, the Republican Party is a much tougher party than it was. The old Republican Party would have buckled. It would have given up on Kavanaugh. I don't think it would have had even the nerve to appoint Amy Coney Barrett. They'd be like, after Ruth Bader Ginsburg, the left will go berserk. We're not going to take our chance on someone who's manifestly pro-life. So they wouldn't have done that. They would have lost their cool. You know, and I think what Trump showed is that the way to fight is to fight on the front line. Don't go into the fetal position. Don't go under your desk. And look at the media. I mean, these are people who have thrown everything that they could at Trump. And still the guy increased his vote total dramatically. Still the guy's standing. He's put labels on them. They can't put labels on him. So I think he's taught us a lot. He's also transformed the composition of the right. He's essentially moved us from the party of the rich and the stuffy people into the party of the working class. Now, think about it. Any party that long term that's the party of the middle class and the working class has a great future in American politics. The Democrats are the party of academia and the media and the lawyers. So they've got a niche, and they have some billionaires on their side. They've got sort of these leftist billionaires. And then, of course, they've got all these foreign forces that are in there. So one of the themes of Trump card is to look at Islamic intervention in American politics. So the left keeps talking about, you know, Russia collusion, five Russians who bought a Facebook ad who apparently rigged the last election. But there's a lot of foreign intervention from other parties that has gotten no media coverage at all.
John asks, what do you have to say to the Lincoln Project?
Well, first of all, if Abraham Lincoln were alive, he'd send over a grant to round these guys up. He'd probably have to round them up at a local Starbucks. But a more dishonest, useless bunch of characters I have yet to encounter. And I say this with a little bit of poignancy because some of these people were my friends. I came of age with these guys. I was at institutions like the American Enterprise Institute and the Hoover Institution where these guys hang out. Now look, there is a sort of honest phenomenon of the Republican who's a little dismayed by Trump's persona. I grant that. But that is not the Lincoln Project. The Lincoln Project is now an attempt to subvert, not just Trump, but the Republican Party, to sell out to the other side, to take money from the liberal billionaires. All these people are looking for careers on the left. They're looking to accommodate themselves to a leftist regime. So this is the Benedict Arnold faction, if you will, of the Republican Party. And it's being funded by the other side in full recognition of this. So these guys know that they're useful idiots, but they're not really idiots. They're extremely cunning opportunists who know what they're doing and are doing it ultimately to advance their careers.
Michael asks, why do so many conservatives deny that systemic racism does not exist when data proves that it actually does?
Well, systemic racism is normally defined as racism that is inferred, not proven, inferred from disparate outcomes. It's kind of like saying that each racial group didn't hit the finishing tape at the same time, and therefore the race must have been rigged. So it's a way of reasoning backward. I mean, I've been studying this topic most of my adult life. It goes back to my book, The End of Racism, that looks at this very carefully. I'll mention in this context, several years ago, a Young America's Foundation event, I debated Jesse Jackson. I believe this was at Stanford, about this topic. And I was straight with him. I said, Reverend Jackson, you know, I admit that in a big country you can find examples of racism, but show me a racism right now, today, in America, that can prevent you or me or your children or mine from achieving the American dream. Where's that racism? Show it to me. And he couldn't. He was like, oh, I cannot show it to you, Dinesh. And his argument was this, and you can just see how evasive it is. He goes, well, the fact that I can't prove it to you or show it to you doesn't mean it doesn't exist. The racism has gone underground. It's now covert instead of overt. So ultimately, I think what's going on here is it's an appeal to phantoms. The real data, let's look, for example, at the data in the way cops, for example, approach people. You know, here's LeBron James, sort of like, you know, I'm more likely to be stopped by a cop than a working class white guy. First of all, that is manifestly untrue. If any cop stops LeBron James, it's probably to get his picture, you know, get a selfie, get his autograph. So this notion that some honest, law-abiding black guy just walk into school, walk into work, and man, the cops should descend on him, start beating him, this is nonsense. The reason that all these cases from George Floyd to Blake, at every single case, you've got a home invader over here, and you've got a guy who's attacking his girlfriend, a third guy with a knife, is because this is the typical case. The typical case is not the guy simply going about his lawful business when he gets menaced by the police. Those cases evidently are so rare that the left has to celebrate convicts in order to make its point.
A viewer on Instagram asks, is the American dream dead?
No, it's not dead. It's not even close to being dead. We shouldn't be apocalyptic about the country. There's no such thing as we're done. There may be such a point. We're not even close to that point. If we lose this, let's say we lost the honest fight, and believe me, we've lost under Obama, we accepted that. So this is not about the fact that we lost. If we lost straightforwardly, we lost according to fair rules, then we lost. What do? We regroup, and we try to claim the Senate and the House in the midterm. We try to take the whole Congress in the midterm. And then we try to win the presidency the next time around. Now, obviously, we want to be confident that the systemic problems, vote rigging, dubious ways of counting the ballot, that there are fair procedures in place. So one of the most important things I hope the Supreme Court does is define a legal vote. This is what a legal vote is, and only these votes that satisfy this clear criteria, will be counted in the future. So I think our future as conservatives is bright. I go back to the Reagan agenda. Reagan basically said he stood for five things: the individual, the family, the church, local self-government, the community, and the country. I mean, any philosophy, any party that stands on those principles, and very interestingly, the left today is in some important way against all five. They don't like individual opportunity. They don't like the patriarchal family. They don't like the church and will impose differential restrictions. They don't like local self-government. And they don't like the flag or the national anthem. And they want to rewrite the whole country's history to make it a series of uninterrupted crimes. So the bottom line of it is, I think that we have a winning philosophy, a hopeful agenda. Our long-term prospects are bright. We just have to shut down the institutional gangsterism.
Another viewer on Instagram asks, is it time to abolish the Electoral College? Why do we still give deference to this outdated system?
I don't think it is outdated. Something is not outdated because it existed in 1789. You can go back and read Aristotle's Ethics, in which he talks about the basic principles of morality. Are those outdated because Aristotle wrote in the 5th century BC? Of course not. Why? Because moral principles are not like fashion. They're not like technology. They don't change automatically or become progressively better. So the fallacy of progressivism is to apply to philosophy and to morals, a principle that we concede in the domain of, let's say, technology. We understand, for example, that phones are going to get better and there are going to be new gimmicks and devices that we didn't have before. In that sense, there is progress. But moral progress is a little bit of a different idea altogether. Now, the Electoral College is an effort, along with many other institutions, to create, I would call it, block and tackle in American government. We don't want untrammeled majority rule. Now, the left does. That's why they say things like, the American people are against Amy Coney Barrett. First of all, it's not true. But let's say they were. The judiciary is supposed to be a check on the American people. The point of having a judiciary, a Supreme Court, is to say to the American people, no, even if 99% of you want to stop this one guy, Dinesh, from talking, you can't. Even though you want to stop him from professing his conscience, you can't. Even though you want to stop him from owning a gun, you can't. Even though you want to unreasonably search and seize him, you can't. Even though you want to block his freedom of assembly, you can't. So the point is that the Bill of Rights asserts rights that we never gave over to the government, and the court is the custodian of those. Bottom line is that these various instruments are checks. There, we allow an expression of majority rule, and at the same time, we curtail it in areas where it can become tyrannical. To quote Jefferson, an elective despotism is not what we fought for. I think that principle remains as true today.
We have time for one final question, and this question comes from Alexandra. She asks, is COVID over now that the election is over?
Well, I hope we can see the light at the end of the tunnel, but I do think it is, this is a crisis, this is an epidemic, a real epidemic, by the way, but one that was politically harnessed and exploited in ruthless ways. In fact, COVID has given us the closest preview or window into what socialism looks like, because not only has it been an opportunity for economic shutdown and for the government to sort of take over and control the levers of industry, but it has also been we have seen a systematic erosion of basic civil rights. The Bill of Rights nowhere says that you have a right to free speech except for a virus. You have a right to go to church except for a virus. And yet these Democratic mayors and governors have been literally running roughshod over the Constitution. One idiot, I believe in New Jersey, he's like, I didn't even think about the Constitution. I mean, this dope, you know, is obviously an elected official, and a high elected official, and the Constitution doesn't even cross his mind.
Well, I wish we could keep doing this all night, but Dinesh has already been very generous with his time. I'm glad we got to go through so many of your great questions tonight, and if we didn't get to yours, I promise we'll be doing more virtual events soon, so don't give up on trying. Remember, subscribe or follow to make sure you get a notification every single time we go live. Dinesh, thank you again for being with us tonight.
Always a pleasure.
And thank you to everyone at home for joining us for this live event to discuss the future of the American dream moving past 2020. I want to give another special thank you to Keith Work for making tonight's special event possible. Before I let you go, did you know that you can now become an official card-carrying member of Young Americans for Freedom? Whether you are new to the conservative movement or have been a member of a Young Americans for Freedom chapter for years, it's completely free to sign up, and when you do, you'll receive exclusive YAF swag, your very own membership card, and exclusive opportunities to attend unique members-only events. Did I mention it's 100% free? All you have to do is visit students.yaf.org to sign up today. Thank you again for being here, and we'll see you next time.